You're welcome to the Policy Council. My name is Okwemi Agbaje. In 2013, the e-commerce sector seemed to have taken off in Nigeria. This week, we discuss that sector. I try to understand the factors driving growth. I try to understand the significant challenges, what we can learn from the global environment. And I talked to one of the Nigerians leading the transformation of that sector. Enjoy the program. You're welcome back to the Policy Council. My guest today is a fantastic guest. He's the CEO of Konga.com. He holds an Harvard MBA. He attended George Washington and Dartmouth University in the U.S., Ivy League institutions. He's worked in Google, in Rand Merchant Bank, and now he set up this online retail platform in Nigeria that is making waves, Konga.com. I thought we would enjoy a conversation with him. Sim Shagaya, you're welcome to the Policy Council.
Thanks, Okwemi. Very kind introduction.
Well, it's true. I think they're all facts. And there's some things I like about your background. Dartmouth, for once.
Yes.
I tried to get my son into Dartmouth. He ended up at the University of Illinois.
That's a great school, too.
Yeah. And then my daughter has this aspiration, just finishing at Cambridge, wants to do an MBA at Harvard.
Oh, fantastic.
So I'll call you when the time is. How was working in Google? Okay. I should start from there.
Google is a special company. Mm. It's filled with incredibly talented people. Mm. A lot of Nigerians, you'd be happy to hear. Hmm. Very difficult to get into. First of all, I think I went through personally about 10 interviews. Wow. Before being accepted for the job, and everybody had to say yes. Hmm. But very innovative company. Obviously, the biggest.
What did you study?
Electrical engineering.
Okay.
Obviously, the biggest search engine in the world that creates revenues through advertising. And you have to be very, very creative, very sort of forward-thinking and willing to challenge norms and rules constantly. So I was working with them and bringing them to Africa for the first... Actually, I was the first African employee.
Hmm.
So I was in Nigeria, no office. Office was in London, but running around Africa with a briefcase.
Hmm.
It was a lot of
fun. How long were you in Google?
2 years.
Okay, and then you concluded that you have to replicate something in the IT space.
Something similar.
In Nigeria.
Yeah, one of the benefits of having been in the United States during what you call this first internet boom was you saw what the internet was doing to all kinds of spheres, your industry, media, and then the things we're doing now, commerce.
Mm.
So I remember then watching the rise of Amazon and eBay and some of these companies with fascination and wondering when will the time be ready for us to do something similar to Nigeria. Mm. And the time finally came. So 2 years ago, so we started Konga.
Was your time in Rand before or after Google?
It was before Google.
Okay. And what were you doing in finance?
In investment banking. I know, that's a really good question. No, so I'd finished business school. I knew it was time for me to return to the continent.
Mm.
I actually wanted to come back home, but I thought, okay, let me try and see Africa first. Mm-hmm. And there was this investment bank. They have a presence now in Nigeria, very innovative investment bank, RMB. And I interviewed with them, and they gave me an offer, and I accepted it only on the basis, not because of the banking itself, but because they say, oh, you have a chance to see Congo and Burkina and all of these other African countries, Namibia, and we're doing transactions everywhere. So I said, okay, here's a chance to see Africa. I'd only been to Nigeria, Ghana, and South Africa. So I said, if somebody's going to pay for me to see the rest of the continent, I'll take the job.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I've listened to you in one forum talk about the fact that you considered an online university and e-commerce business. Tell us about that.
Okay, so let's see. So what's common about both of them? The first thing is that they both rise on what I believe, personally, is the rise of African consumerism and a changing Africa. So and they both try to address what I think are very big problems. So online universities, of course, I think seek to address the challenge of education in Africa. I think that the traditional model, whether I'm doing it or not, and maybe this would inspire other people to pursue this, the traditional method of brick and mortar universities cannot address the demand of, say, 60 million young Nigerians that are trying to get into tertiary institutions at the same time. Speak less of across the continent. We have to be able to use the internet somehow. So that was that. And then at the same time, the internet also creates ways for us to serve Africans that want to consume good things, nice things at great prices. Mm-hmm. So that was the Konga opportunity. The first was education. The second was e-commerce.
E-commerce.
Yes. So, yeah.
So in the end, what factors shaped your choice?
To be completely frank?
Yes.
So I think the thing I love about retail and e-commerce and building this platform called Konga is that it's subject to minimal government regulation.
Hmm.
So we pay our taxes, of course, and we have to comply with some statutory things here and there at the edges, and that's fine.
Mm.
But
the online university, you need 200 hectares of land.
And it's in the constitution of the country or something. So we need to revisit those bylaws of the constitution. Yeah, and you need all kinds of things to be able to just start a university here.
Mm.
So I looked at the two and I thought, okay, if I want to kind of minimize stress at this point in my life, let's stay away from heavily regulated sectors.
Excellent. Great stuff. Let's take a time out. I'm talking to Sim Shagaya. He's doing a fantastic job creating a fantastic platform. We'll be right back.
Who knows Abi better thing? Abi who know like better thing? Who these fine things where they see so? Now money government they take do and now? Abi? I think it's like, you know? I mean? Excuse me, I did pay my tax. I did do a thing. I did pay my tax. Say you don't pay your own tax. If you pay your tax, I pay.
Pay your tax. It's your civic responsibility. It's your duty. It's the law.
You welcome back. Still the policy council. My guest is Sim Shagaya. He's becoming well known as the CEO of Konga.com. He's a Harvard MBA. He's a graduate of George Washington and Dartmouth, ex-Google, and now running Konga.com. So, Sim, let me ask you. You've been at Konga.com since June 2012.
Exactly.
Tell us how the journey has been,
okay,
creating the institution, creating the technology, the platforms, sure, entering the market space.
Sure, absolutely. So like you rightly mentioned, we are now approaching our second year.
Mm.
It's been a whirlwind journey. Mm. And the brand has grown very quickly, and Nigerians have embraced us.
Mm.
So I think the whole idea started in 2011, around October, when we were looking at internet penetration, and it wasn't just me, I mean, I think people are quick to give me credit, but it was actually a group of us in the beginning.
Mm.
And we're looking at internet penetration, looking at the penetration of mobile devices. You could all of a sudden do things on your mobile phone you couldn't really do before in Lagos. And we said, okay, maybe the time is right for us to try this thing again. And so we picked some categories to start selling in. We started out selling baby and beauty products initially. Our thinking was that the woman is kind of, she drives the spending in the household.
Yeah.
So if we could attack those categories first, we could kind of make our way into the household, and then we start to spread the categories.
Yeah.
So we started off selling beauty and baby products. Our first order was in June 2012, and it's grown very quickly since then. Now we do electronics, fridges, appliances. And most importantly, what we're really proud of is that now on Konga, we're not the only ones selling. We've now opened up the platform to other Nigerians in a very aggressive manner. So anybody can come and create a shop on Konga and have access to the same sort of market that we have.
Why do you do that? That's like creating...
Yes.
Well, the myopic way is to look at it as creating competition for
yourself.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I don't think so at all. Okay. I mean, I think if you look at it, there is no way that one party, no matter how innovative it is, like a Konga, can fight the collective commercial energy of Nigerians.
Mm.
If we say we're going to be the only ones buying and selling, it seems like we are sort of, it's a conqueror mentality.
Mm.
It's like you're trying to take over everything. You're trying to destroy Alaba, you're trying to destroy Computer Village, you're trying to destroy Ariaria, you're trying to destroy all these markets.
Mm.
No, instead, what we should be trying to do is to infuse technology into all of these marketplaces. And it's good for us also. We can focus on what we're really good at, on technology.
Okay.
And building solutions to help Africans to trade.
Okay.
So
how do you, what's your prognosis for the sector? What are you seeing in that e-payments or e-commerce space?
Yeah.
That gives you the confidence to venture into it, to probably stake a lot into it. And what do you see? What's your prognosis for e-commerce?
You know, I can sit here and pretend like I see the future, or I saw the future when we started. But to be more honest, and this is more encouraging to other entrepreneurs who are trying similar things, you just start, and then you start to see signs. And the signs that we're seeing today are really, really good.
Okay.
It suggests to us that, you know, the same way that Nigeria leapfrog fixed line and went straight to mobile, we strongly believe we're going to leapfrog brick and mortar stores and go straight to e-commerce. And we're seeing the same thing happen, at least as far as Konga is concerned. We're seeing orders coming from everywhere. You won't believe it. If we look at our top 1,000 customers in terms of spending, people who spend the highest, what you call basket size in Nigeria, the top Lagos basket comes from Agege, not Ikoyi, shockingly. We're delivering across the country, even regions that are challenged geopolitically, security-wise right now. Orders are going through. And so we're seeing Nigerians embrace this in a very, very real way. And I think we're only still only scratching the surface of what's available here. Like I said before, I think Konga will only, the flower will only truly bloom when we're not the only ones selling, and we can enable this platform, enable a technology and a logistics platform so that any Nigerian trading anything can sell on the platform.
There was a Christmas promotion you had. I had the story. Tell us about it.
Oh, the fall yakata sale. That was an interesting day. Nigerians basically crashed our website, I think, that day. We had, so, you know, there's the United States, they have a day called Black Friday, when they drop prices and everybody shops online, offline. Or some people call it Cyber Monday. We said, let's localize it. We'll call it Yakata. We'll call it the Fall Yakata Sale. And I guess the name spread quicker than we thought. If I can get a bit technical, if you don't mind.
Please, go ahead.
Before that day, we had quadrupled our computer server capacity in anticipation of the traffic. Quadrupled. We said, okay, the traffic will grow 4 times. But on that day, we saw the traffic to our website grow 16 times.
Wow.
So by about 9 in the morning, the website collapsed.
Wow.
It was very stressful, as you'd imagine. Very challenging for the team and I. But at the end of the day, even the crashing of the site became word on the street. People started talking about it. They were laughing about it. And today we look back at it. We've learned our lesson. Hopefully it won't happen again.
Are you going to do another Yakata?
We'll do it. It's going to be an annual. You are going to quadruple times.
Times
100. But that day, on that day, we sold more goods in the morning than we did in the entire preceding month. So Nigerians really...
So in 1 hour before...
In 6 hours, between before, about 6 a.m. to noon, we sold more than in the whole of October.
Excellent stuff. Let's take a short time out. I'm talking to fascinating discussion to Sim Shagaya of Konga, and we're looking at e-commerce, e-payments, all of that in Nigeria. We'll be right back. You're welcome back. It's the Policy Council, and my guest is Sim Shagaya of Konga. Sim, let me ask you, you spoke off camera about 2 different types of e-commerce, one you call marketplace and retail. Tell us about that. What's the difference?
That's a very, very good question. It's a little technical, but I'll try and explain it.
Okay.
So most people in the world, not only in Nigeria, across the world, confuse the two. There are actually 2 flavors of e-commerce. Okay. One is retail and the other is marketplace.
Okay.
Retail is where a company will buy things, keep it in a warehouse, and sell those things. So you are the owner of the goods being sold. Marketplace, on the other hand, is where you create a platform for anybody to come and sell to anybody else. And you try and be a broker of trust. You try and say, okay, you know what? Okoyemi has sold this item 10 times. His rating is 90%. He's a trustworthy person. You can do business with him. That is marketplace. The biggest example of the first one is Amazon, where they buy and they sell. The biggest examples of the second one are eBay and Alibaba, which most people would have heard of the two.
Yeah.
It turns out that different countries, the culture and the economic development and the state of the economic development of different countries serve one or the other. For us at Konga, what we learned is that it was good to start as a retailer.
Okay.
But I think what will really serve Nigeria, what is really going to grow in Nigeria going forward is this marketplace.
Okay.
If you look at every Nigerian, we're all entrepreneurs at the end of the day.
Hmm.
I'm sure some of your crew here.
Trade online.
Trade, too. Exactly. So everybody's looking to build a website. Everybody's looking to connect to a payment gateway. Everybody's looking for a bike to carry their things up and down. And what we're saying is, you know what? Okay, you know what? Focus on getting your inventory. Focus on sewing the clothing, on getting the goods, on producing from the farm. And we will focus on the technology to give you a platform to reach any corner of Nigeria. And that's marketplace.
Okay.
We may continue to sell some things in that marketplace. But I think by and large, in the future, we expect that the vast majority of things that will be sold on Konga will be provided by Nigerians themselves. So as a member of the Konga community, you can be a buyer and a seller. You may buy today and sell tomorrow.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. So how's competition for you in that space? I know about your most popular competitor.
Yes.
I don't know whether I want to name them, but we know. Is it hot? Is it intense? Is it just...
Well, I think in the beginning it certainly was. I mean, I think when any business is starting out and is a baby, you are unsure of yourself, you're unsure of your footing. But as we've gone along, we've become more confident. We think that... you know, I've never been an advocate of protectionism or anything like that. I think it's very important that I think competition is good for the consumer. And it's even good for us as Konga. It makes us run fast.
Yeah.
But what we're finding is that because we are, how can I say it, built of Nigerian intent for Nigerian intent by Nigerians, if you know what I mean, we can localize and provide solutions for Nigerians, which is what we hope. To be completely honest with you, I'm not just saying this. If somebody can produce a better platform than Konga, can serve Nigerians better than we can, let them go ahead, by all means. But we are more long, I think we are very long-term thinking. We're building this thing. I think the only way you really win, to the degree you can win anything at this game, is to think first about the customer. And that's all Konga focuses on. We don't focus on competition. We look at competition sometimes to try and make life better for our customer. But at the end of the day, the person that sits on the throne is the customer. And so long as you focus on the customer, not just in e-commerce, on anything. Telecom services, it doesn't matter. You do okay. You do fine.
What do you think are the fundamental factors driving or that will drive the growth of e-commerce in
Nigeria? Wow. That's a fantastic question. The basic one is the rise of broadband.
Okay.
The increasing penetration of broadband. Broadband needs to get faster, quicker. There are all kinds of companies that are doing great things around that. Main One, Glow One, the telcos. The government recently licensed this 2.3 gigahertz spectrum. I think that's going to be a big boost for Nigeria. And then, of course, the second big thing, Okwemi, is the proliferation and the cheapening of mobile devices. So I think starting next year, you're going to start to see incredibly powerful smartphones and tablets for under 15, 10,000 naira start to penetrate into the market. Already the prices are falling.
Yeah.
A smartphone you pay 15,000 naira for today, you might pay 60,000 naira for a few years ago.
Yeah.
So we're going to see more powerful, smarter devices working their way into the society. Okay. That's the second thing. But in spite of all of this, we can't forget even the more basic things. We think the journey of Konga is not a 2-3 year journey, it's a 20-year journey. Hopefully it will be the journey of Nigeria. If we really want to see e-commerce, remember e-commerce is just commerce with E in front of it. We need continued economic growth, which hopefully will be accelerated by the liberalization of the power sector.
Okay.
We need a widening middle class. We need the poverty rate in this country, or the, it could, I mean, 60 million people in poverty is just not acceptable. We need a much thinner poverty segment, eliminated ideally, and much wider middle class. So I think these are the things that will drive it going forward.
Okay, stop. Okay, let's take our final time out. I'm talking to Sim Shagaya, and we're trying to understand the e-commerce space in Nigeria. We'll be right back.
Government wants our city to become a mega modern city. And so, government is providing modern markets for us to carry out our business. Now, this requires money. So, we need to pay our taxes to help government to help us. I pay my taxes. I hope you've paid yours. I pay. Pay your tax. It's your civic responsibility. It's your duty. It's the law.
Okay. You're welcome back. It's the Policy Council. It's my final segment with Sim Shagaya of Konga.com. We're having a very fascinating discussion. Sim, let me ask you. E-commerce is indeed, we're late comers in Nigeria. So what can we learn from outside? What's going on in the global space that should interest us?
Oh, yeah, I think
e-commerce.
No, I think if there's one particular region that we can learn from Okupami is the Far East.
Okay.
The country, the government specifically, has taken an active role in encouraging the rise of this sector, whether from enabling a cashless society, which we're doing the central bank up until this point has done really well, and that has to continue. It must continue. And then the second thing is there's all kinds of legislation that is now being passed specifically at the national level, even of China, to protect consumers, make sure consumers are treated fairly in online marketplaces, for example. We have to start thinking on that level. The National Assembly has to start paying attention to this sector.
Okay.
Today, for example, Alibaba, which is a company we're all familiar with, is responsible or trades on its platform the equivalent of 5% of Chinese GDP.
Wow.
And that's not a trivial amount. I think last year, nominally, that was about $190 billion.
Wow.
It represents about half of Nigeria's GDP before this rebasing, whatever the rebasing, half of Nigeria's GDP.
Traded by one
e-commerce player, and there are maybe six or seven big ones. So it's a really big thing. The other thing that we've noticed also that I hope will happen here, and I hope Konga will be a force for, is that Alibaba has actually become a force in China for reducing urbanization. They are actually sellers now on their marketplaces that are happy to stay in the rural areas because they are earning as much selling from the rural areas as they would if they moved to a city. These e-commerce platforms are even changing urban planning, changing the way cities are designed. I think it's our future. So, you know, I think, you know, we've seen state governments, notably Lagos, play an active role in encouraging some of this. I think we would do better to see more state governments engage with the participants in this sector, the federal government engage with the participants in this sector, and see how we can develop this better. Firstly, to the betterment of the consumer, the Nigerian. But of course, to help the whole industry to thrive.
What are the most important challenges you face?
Oh, there are many. I mean, some of them are unique to Nigeria, some are not.
Power. that's unique to Nigeria. Hopefully, that will begin to
change. It will be solved hopefully in the next 2 or 3 years or so. One that is unique to Nigeria also is the absence of logistics. Although surprisingly, EMS, and which is the courier arm of NIPOST, is getting more effective. But Konga has to build its own logistics. We own a fleet of motorbikes and vans. In other countries, the e-commerce companies would not have to make that investment.
Okay.
It means that we have to actually invest in things we shouldn't be investing in. Some of the things that are common to maybe Nigeria, India, and even China is this cash on delivery problem. I call it a problem because it's not ideal. It's a very expensive thing. Some of it is trust-based, meaning that Nigerians or people in emerging markets like Nigeria they want you to deliver to them, and when they see it and look at it, then they pay for it. And that's understandable. But some of it is even still technical, is that the electronic payment channels don't work as well as they should sometimes. Sometimes the POS machines don't work, the platforms that the ATM machines, all of that run on, are not really quite there yet. So I think the push towards a cashless Nigeria will solve the latter part of the problem. And then as Konga satisfies Nigerians more and more, you see the trust side fall away. Yeah, I mean, if you look at the United States, there's no such thing as cash on delivery. Europe.
You pay online and you get
it. You get it, and if you don't get if you're not happy, you get a refund immediately to your card. Today, for example, we can't do a refund to a customer's card. That's a problem. So if you buy something from us, you're not happy, you're not satisfied, and I want to refund you, I have to call you and ask you for your bank details and start doing a bank transfer outside when I should just be able to just credit your card and say sorry. You know, so there are things like that that we have to deal with.
What's the outlook for Konga? Where are you going to? What do you see over the next 3 years?
Our vision is to be the engine of commerce for Africa.
Okay.
And we want to build a Pan-African marketplace that hopefully will become part of culture, that becomes used so much that it disappears from use. You don't talk about it anymore. You're not surprised by it. Where somebody who's sitting in Monrovia or in Dakar can order Gele from Lagos, and Konga facilitates not only the transaction between those those two participants sitting in very different parts of West Africa, but also the logistics of getting those goods. Can you imagine the wealth we can unlock? And of course, the other things that have to happen, you know, monetary union and a common ECOWAS. So that's why I say these things are not necessarily 5 years. I mean, Konga's, you know, the Konga flower will only really bloom, I think, in 10 years, 15 years. So it's going to take some time.
Well, congratulations on what you've done so far.
Thank you.
You're doing a great job.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. The story of Konga is one of the more inspirational stories in Nigeria and in Africa. The story of Sim Shagaya is one example of a Nigerian with a good international exposure in education, in some professional training, who has brought the benefits of the diaspora back into the Nigerian environment. The story of the e-payments revolution, I would dare to call it, especially around 2013 going forward, is a story of the possibilities of the Nigerian economy. I hope we lead this transition, this opportunity, to the realization of the economic benefits that e-commerce and greater economic development can bring. Thank you very much for watching. See you next time.